neighborhood, in any garage, you never know what you're gonna find. We found Harry's 1970 Datsun 510. Took him 2 years to build. He and his wife out of this two-car garage all by themselves. And this car was rough. Morning.
How's it going?
Good. You know what? Why a Datsun?
Well, you know, Datsuns and I have a history. We've been together for a long time. I've had them since I was 16. Okay. I've had probably half a dozen of them.
You grew up on the Big Island.
The Big Island of Hawaii.
Born and raised there. Right. You and your wife.
Me and my wife, Shelly.
So you guys were dating. You had this car. But this wasn't the car. What happened to the car?
So the car probably is disintegrated. It's probably lying in the brush somewhere up in Hawaiian Acres, rusted down to nothing. Mm-hmm. Sad, but you know, we left Hawaii back in 97, and we moved up here to California, and we've been here ever since. So a couple years ago, got a crazy idea, and I told Shelly, I was like, hey, let's get another 510, and let's build it. Flew up to Washington, went to a U-Haul, grabbed the box van, car transport. There wasn't any engine or transmission in it. The rear tail section was just horrific. Customized the rear.
Wait,
put some circle lights on it.
It wasn't just customizing the rear. It was like this horrible Frankenstein of, what was it, a Skyline rear end or something?
I don't know what he was trying to go for. And Shelly wasn't happy because the car was tore up pretty bad. But, you know, I knew deep down inside I could fix it.
Right.
You know, no matter what it took.
Your fenders were really rough. I mean, you had a lot of things going on. Tell me what you actually did.
So the fenders, I didn't even bother trying to fix. So I went ahead and bought some replica fenders. And then the hood was kind of rough, but fixable.
Yeah.
But the rear quarter panels were horrible.
Right. Wait. Where's your fuel door?
What the heck? That's how I got the car. The car didn't have a fuel door. And I thought it was pretty cool. It keeps the streamline of the supersonic line, that's what this line is actually called.
So your supersonic line here was part of your decision to not take off this fender and start over.
There's a lot of work that is involved when you remove the rear quarter panel from a car and graft the new one on. And I'd have to do both sides because the other side was just as rough as this side. I was concerned that replacing both quarters and the taillight panel might compromise the integral structure of the car. Mm-hmm. Shelly was actually really helpful when it came down to, you know, the fine tuning of the body work, because her eyes are better than mine.
And plus, this is her side of the car.
That too.
She wants it to look really
good. She wanted
her
side of the car. I probably redid this side maybe about 20 times. Mm-hmm. She actually stripped this whole side down to bare metal.
Doing a two-stage paint without a paint booth, that's a lot of coats. Why didn't you do a single stage?
So the main reason is because I was trying to replicate the car that I was driving when Shelly and I first started dating. That's one. And then two, the white line will draw the eye away from the imperfections. So mask the bodywork in a sense. Premium body filler, and the paint that I use is actually really good paint too as well. I used a polyurethane primer, and I had two big fans at the back door pulling air out of the garage, and then the garage door was cracked about maybe that much. Mm-hmm. And that is the original tank. So normally you wouldn't see the gas tank, you wouldn't see the spare.
Would have all been covered off.
Right.
You could hide a dead body in there.
Yeah. I'll be a small dead body.
What part of this did you have to cut out to get rid of that hideous taillight section?
So I literally had to cut from here.
Okay.
To here.
Right.
And then separate that seam at the bottom. I had to basically weld the replacement panel on with a cheap welder I got from Harbor Freight.
You did all this with Harbor Freight tools pretty much, right?
Right, down to the spray gun. In fact, that spray gun I'm gonna use again.
I have a Harbor Freight spray gun, I know.
It works really good.
I actually know. So you have so many parts on this car that are original, or at least tried to keep that original look. That was important to you.
It was, yeah. You know, I think the car looked good the way it was back in the day. back in the 70s and the 80s, they were everywhere. Mm-hmm. It was one of those cars that you would just, that's just a Datsun. Where now people look at it and be like, wow, Datsun 510, I remember those. You know, 96 horsepower was pretty good for a four-cylinder back then. Mm-hmm. You know, the car scooted along really well.
Yeah, and its 0 to 60 was actually faster than its competition, except until you got into like a BMW 1600 or something. This was faster than a Beetle, faster than a Mini, and still pretty affordable.
It was a more than practical car, I thought, at that time.
Yeah, and they rallied these too, yeah?
Yeah.
Your tire looks good. That's a good balancing act. You got a little bit bigger wheel here with still some adequate tire on there.
These are Ensign Sprints made by American Racing, and they were the closest that I could find to the actual Ensigns that I had on my car when we were in Hawaii. Mm-hmm. And they're 15 by 7. I was able to stretch a 175 on there, and it gives it just enough roll on the outside edge.
With the strut suspension, it's really hard to lower this car, isn't it?
It is. Eddie, they originally come with shocks and springs in the back and then struts in the front. Mm-hmm. So in order to get the height that I wanted and the ride that I wanted, I actually had to go outside the box, and I got some adjustable coilover shocks. Mm-hmm. Replace all the bushings from Energy Suspension. I had a friend powder coat a lot of the control arms, the K-member.
Mm-hmm. Did you upgrade these brakes?
No,
they're
the original brakes that would have came with the car. Just had the backing plates powder coated, put all new hardware on, cleaned up the adjuster. New wheel cylinder.
Show me what's under here.
It's just a little itty bitty 1600.
Sure. It's not, dude, this looks still completely like, was it the L16?
Yeah.
That was originally in here.
Right.
You've done some crazy stuff here, and this is where I want you to tell me what the hell you did here.
So it's actually a 2.2 liter early model 200SX block, and the cylinder head is from a 78 Datsun L20B.
But then you had some issues with your cooling.
Right.
What did you have to do to make it work?
So on the Z engine, which is a cross-flow engine.
And tell me what that means. So cool that you have all these spare blocks and heads. Tell me what you've got going on here.
So I just kind of lay these out really quick so you can kind of see the differences in the two engines. So this is the Z engine. Mm-hmm.
The Z22.
This is the Z22, which is actually what's in the car right now.
Right.
And this is a L16.
Okay.
These passages right here.
Yeah.
There's nothing on this side.
Okay. So all your
cooling is getting pumped from the water pump into this passage. Mm-hmm. It comes up on this side, goes into the head, crosses over, and then it exits out here.
Okay.
So on the Z engine, the coolant gets pumped up on this side of the block, comes over, and then exits here. So I had to drill these holes.
So why go through all of that? I mean, you probably could have just done an entirely different engine swap or something new and modern, and why go through all of those hoops?
You know, I really wanted to keep it looking like the original style L series engine.
Yeah.
That's the main reason. And I wanted people to look under the hood and be like, oh, it's a little 1600 and not know that it's actually a 2.2. Mm-hmm.
So what do you got moving backward in this drivetrain? Tell me about your transmission setup.
That is a 5-speed out of a 1985 Nissan King Cab pickup. And it's the short shaft transmission. Mm-hmm. They have long and short. And the King Cabs actually had a two-piece drive shaft with a bearing in the middle.
Right.
So that's
like
why
a carrier.
A carrier. So they made the transmission shorter. And that transmission is the same exact length as the original 4-speed in this car. So that was the hot ticket. You could actually use that transmission and put your stock drive shaft back in there and not have an issue, no.
So tell me about what you did with your bell housing.
So because it came off of a Z engine, I had to swap the bell housing and put an L bell housing on it.
And why?
Because the angle of the Z engine and the L engine is a little different. The stick shift ends up being all the way towards.
It's literally to the side. The whole thing rotates.
Yeah, it's clocked incorrectly.
So to keep it in a vertical alignment and be like it should be,
you have to use the L bell housing.
this so is you, still blowing me away that you could figure out all of these, like it's like a trail mix bag. Mm-hmm, yeah. And yet somehow they all work.
Yeah.
You don't have mirrors or visors, but it's okay. It looks really clean. Why did you not put those things on this car?
Honestly, I just couldn't get to a point where I wanted to drill into the door or the fenders. And
so you're sacrificing your ability to see everybody around you so that you don't poke a hole in your car.
I know it sounds ridiculous, but yeah.
Your dash is all stock, isn't it?
Yeah, this car originally didn't have a dash. It had a makeshift dash. It was made out of wood, and there was toggle switches on it. It was a mess. And behind it had a bird nest of, looked like all kinds of different wires. Mm-hmm. And it's just,
it was a mess.
He was using telephone wire and house wires.
What?
Yeah, it was a mess. I almost think this car probably would end up, you know, at a wrecking yard, yeah, crushed, because it had been on Craigslist for a while. Nobody wanted it.
And it's so funny. It's like if you think about the car has a little soul and a history, and if only you could just hear all the things it had to say. It's, yeah, probably feeling really grateful that it's so beautiful now. It's like a rescue puppy.
Yeah. I hope it feels that way.
Yeah. This is a programmable, what is that?
That's the MSD6AL2. It's a programmable spark box. So okay, with that,
spark box.
I tune the ignition so the car accelerates nicely, smoothly, mm-hmm, and you get that peak timing at the right RPM. Mm. So those two switches, yeah, if you want air, you got to pull
your windows.
Them up. Yeah.
No, you got these. What are that? What is that?
Pull them up.
What? What am I doing here? What? Are you kidding me? Okay, so you can't have a visor either because your headliner is so gorgeous that we don't want to put any screw holes in. Wait a minute. What do you do when you go over a railroad crossing? You're supposed to lift your feet, touch a screw, and make a wish. That's where I would always put my finger when I was a kid, on the screw for the visor. You can't do that now.
I grew up in Hawaii. There's no trains there.
That's true. There's no trains in Hawaii.
That's the first time I ever heard that.
Really?
Yeah. Just like a regular car.
It's ready to rock. So we have to put our little windows out.
All right.
Hold on, let's do our little... Oh, that was out. Oh, we're open.
We're going to go left.
We're going to go left. We're right out of the driveway. We aren't going to scrape, are we?
Nope.
Yeah.
Like the 210, the 310, the 510, 610, even an A10.
You were telling me that a lot of people, you know, would have it as a second car in like a snow country because right. they didn't want to trash their good car.
Right, exactly.
I hadn't thought of it that way.
They were known as beaters or grocery getters.
Yeah.
And look at them now. Don't worry about breaking it because I know a guy that can fix it.
So the steering is tight, like it. Corner's pretty good. No power steering.
Nope. It's all man and machine.
Yep.
No assist.
Yep. What's the name of this blue?
This is Supersonic Sky Blue.
You're kidding me.
And I gave it that name.
You gave it, I was like, how can it be called Supersonic Sky Blue?
I had a picture of an AT&T van in my phone, and I was trying to match that blue from the AT&T van. Well, it's got these really tall gears in the back. 354 is the ratio.
Right. So, yeah, with that, you got what, 20 millimeter bigger ring gear in that setup now than it would have been stock. Is that right?
Yeah.
So that's going to handle higher torque. I mean, it probably was sufficient with what it had, but anytime you can, like, not brake.
Right.
It's good, right?
Right.
I like it. You've created a very, reasonably priced, reasonable performance car that you can feel proud of and go take out. And that's ultimately kind of what everybody wants in a car, something right. you feel proud of and go cruise.
Right.
I like it. I like it a lot. It's very comfortable in here. These seats are super comfortable. If you had to go a longer distance, these are not going to fatigue you at all.
Oh, yeah.
These are great.
Yeah.
Really.
These are actually Recaro seats. These seats came with the car.
Wow.
Yeah, they came with the car too.
Is that Skyline rear end? Well, the trade-off was you have a Skyline rear end, but decent seats.
Yeah.
All right, sold.
And the rear differential.
Yeah. Car. I appreciate it.
I love it.
It was cool day. Cool day. You guys have a 510 story. I want to hear about it. If you love this car, let me know, and we'll catch you guys next time. This show is a ton of hours to produce, and we could use your support.
Go to patreon.com/NicoleJohnsonsDetour or check out our merchandise, NicoleJohnsonsDetour.com. In any neighborhood in the United States, you just wait until they see. Because we have found Harry's 19... Don't like it. Harry, I got all excited. Harry, all the way by themselves in the socks. 1970 Datsun 510. And it's not like... Harry, I found a mirror. You said you had no mirrors. Look at that.